Chapter 3. The road was dusty and full of holes. As we drove along, we passed gangs of women in charge of an armed overseer. Filling up the deepest of holes with stones and with anything at hand. As we passed, the soldiers with me yelled rabid remarks and made suggestive gestures. We passed through a populated district and on until we came to grim buildings which must have been a prison. The half track swept on and into a cobbled courtyard. No one was in sight. The men looked about in consternation. Then, as the driver switched off the engine, we became immediately aware of a tremendous clamor, the shouting of men and the fierce barking of dogs. We hurried towards the source of the sound, I with the soldiers. Passing through an open door set in a high stone wall, we saw a strong fence enclosure which seemed to contain about 50 huge mastiffs. Quickly, a man on the edge of the crowd of soldiers outside the enclosed gobbled out his story. The dogs, with human bloodlust upon them, had gone out of hand and had killed and devoured two of their keepers. A sudden commotion and a crowd shifted and swayed. I saw a third man, clinging high up on a wire fence, lose his grip on the wire and fell among the dogs. There was a horrid scream, a blood-chilling sound, and then nothing but a snarling mass of dogs. The corporal turned to me. Hey, you can control dogs. Then turning to a soldier beside him, ask the comrade captain to come this way. Say we have a man here who can control dogs. As the soldier hurried off, I nearly fainted with fright on the spot. Me? Why always me? With difficulties and dangers. Then I looked at the dogs and I thought, why not? These animals are not so fierce as Tibetan mastiffs, and these soldiers smell of fear to the dogs, so the dogs attack. An arrogant-looking captain strode through the crowd, which parted respectfully before him. Stopping a few feet from me, he looked me up and down, and a disdainful sneer passed over his face. Frau Corporal, he said haughtily. What have we here? An ignorant native priest? Comrade Captain, said the corporal, this man was not attacked by our dogs. Sergei bit off the hand of a frontier crosser and gave it to him. Send him into the enclosure, Comrade Captain. The captain frowned, shuffled his feet in dust, and industriously bit his nails. At last he stood up. Yes, I will do it, he said. Moscow said that I must not shoot any more dogs, but they did not tell me what to do when the dogs had the bloodlust. This man, if he is killed, well, it was an accident. If he should live, though very unlikely, we will reward him. He turned and paced about, then stood looking at the dogs, gnawing at the bones of the three keepers whom they had killed and eaten. Turning to the corporal, he said, "See to it, corporal. If he succeeds, you are a sergeant." With that, he hastened away. For a time, the corporal stood wide-eyed. Me, a sergeant, man, he said, turning to me. You tame the dogs, and every man in the frontier patrol will be your friend. Get in. Comrade corporal, I replied, I should like the other three dogs to go in with me. They know me, and they know these dogs. So it shall be, he answered. Come with me, and we will get them. We turned and went out to the trailer of the half-track. I fondled the three dogs, let them lick me, letting them put their smell on me. Then, with the three dogs jostling and bouncing around me, I went to the barred entrance of the enclosure. Armed guards stood by in case any dog escaped. Quickly, the gate was opened in the trifle and I was roughly thrust inside. Dogs rushed at me from everywhere, discouraged most from coming too close to me, but one huge, ferocious beast, obviously the leader, sprang murderously at my throat. For that I was well prepared. As I stepped aside, I gave him a quick thrust in the throat, A judo, or karate as people now term it, thrust which killed him before he landed, before he touched the ground. The body was covered with seething, struggling mass of dogs almost before I could jump out of the way. The snarling and snapping noises were hideous. For a few moments I waited, unarmed, defenseless, thinking only kind and friendly thoughts towards dogs, telling them that by thought that I was not afraid of them, that I was their master. Then they turned and I had a moment of revulsion as I saw the bare skeleton of what moments ago had been the leader. The dogs turned towards me. I sat upon the ground and willed them to do the same. They crouched before me in a half circle, paws outstretched, grinning, tongues lolling lazily, and tails sweeping from side to side. I stood up and called Sergi to my side. Putting my hand on his head, I said loudly, "From now on, you, Sergi, will be the leader of all these dogs, and you will obey me, and I will see, and will see that they obey me." From outside the enclosure came a spontaneous roar of applause. I had forgotten all about the soldiers. As I turned, I saw that they were waving their hands in friendship. The captain, his face soft with excitement, came close to the wire and yelled, "Bring out the bodies of the keepers or their skeletons." Grimly, I walked over to the first body, a shredded bloody mass with the chest bone of a, with the chest bones bare of flesh. I took it by arm and pulled, but the arm came off at the shoulder. Then I pulled the man by the head with his entrails dragging along behind. There was a gasp of horror and I saw that Sergei was walking beside me, carrying the man's arm. Laboriously, I removed all three bodies, or what was left of them. Then, really exhausted with the strain, I stepped to the gate and was let out. The captain stood before me. "You stink," he said. "Get cleaned of the filth of those bodies. You shall remain here for a month looking after the dogs. After a month, they return to their patrol and you can go. You shall have the pay of corporal." He turned to the corporal and said, "As promised, you are now a sergeant from this moment." He turned and walked away, obviously quite delighted with the whole affair. The sergeant beamed upon me. "You are a magic maker. Never will I forget how you killed that dog. Never will I forget the sight of the captain hopping from foot to foot, filming the whole affair. You have done a big thing for yourself. Last time we got a dog riot, we lost 6 men and 40 dogs. Moscow came down heavy on the captain's neck. Told him what would happen if he lost any more dogs. He will treat you good. You mess in with us now. We don't ask questions. But come, you stink," as the captain said. "Wash off all that filth." I always told Andrew he ate too much and smelled bad. Now I have seen him in pieces. I know I was right. I was so tired, so exhausted, that even such macbeth humor as this did not shock me. A group of men, corporals in the mess hall, guffawed loudly and said something to the sergeant. He roared and hastened over to me. "Ha ha, comrade priest," he bellowed, eyes streaming with mirth. "They say you have so much of Andrei's inside on your outside that you shall have all his possessions now he is dead. He has no relatives. We are going to call you Comrade Corporal Andrei for as long as you are here. All that was his is now yours. And you won me many rubles that I bet on you in the enclosure. You are my friend." Sergeant Boris was quite a good fellow at heart. Uncouth, rude in manner, and without any pretense of education, he still showed much friendship to me for securing his promotion. I have been a corporal all my life. I would have been a corporal all my life else, he said, for the large number of rubles he had won on me. A number of men had been saying that I had not a chance in the dog enclosure. Boris had heard and said, "My man is good. You should have seen him when he set the dogs on him. Don't move. Sat like a statue. Didn't move. Sat like a statue. The dogs thought he was one of them. He will get the crowd straightened out, you'll see.
Bet on it, Boris, cried one man.
Take you three months to pay, said Boris. As a direct outcome, he had won about 3.5 years of pay and was grateful. That night, after a very ample supper, for the water patrolmen lived well, I slept in a warm hut by the side of the dog enclosure. The mattress was well stuffed with dried esparto grass, and the men had obtained new blankets for me. I had every reason to be grateful for the training which gave me such an understanding of animals' nature. At first light, I was dressed and went to see the dogs. I had been shown where their food was kept, and now I saw that they had a very good feed indeed. They clustered around me, tails a wag, and every so often one would rear up and put his paws on my shoulder. At one such time, I happened to look around, and there was the captain outside the wire, of course, looking at me. "Ah, priest," he said, "I merely came to see why the dogs were so quiet. Feeding time was a time of madness and fights, with the keeper standing outside and throwing food in, with the dogs daring at each other to get their share. I will ask you no questions, priest. Give me your word to remain here for 4 to 5 weeks until the dogs all move out, and you shall have the run of the place and go to the city if you want to go."
"Comrade captain," I replied, "I will gladly give you my word to remain here until all these dogs leave. Then I will be on my way."
"Another matter, priest," said the captain. "At the first feeding time, I will bring my cine camera and take a film so that the superiors can see how we keep our dogs in order. Go to the quartermaster and draw a new corporal's uniform. And if you can find anyone to help you in the enclosure, get them to clean it thoroughly. If they are afraid, do it yourself."
"I will do it myself, comrade captain," I replied. "Then the dogs will not be upset."
The captain nodded curtly and marched off, obviously a very happy man that he could now show that he managed the bloodlusting dogs. For 3 days, I did not move more than 100 yards from the dog's enclosure. These men were trigger happy and thought nothing of shooting into the bushes in case there should be spies hiding, as they put it. For 3 days, I rested, regaining my strength and mixing with the men, getting to know them, getting to know their habits. Andre had been much the same size as me, so his clothes fit reasonably well. Everything of his had to be washed and washed again, though, because he had not been noted for cleanliness. Many times the captain approached me, trying to engage me in conversation, but while he seemed genuinely interested and friendly enough, I had to remember my role of a simple priest who merely understood the Buddhist scriptures and dogs. He would sneer at religion, saying that it was that there was no afterlife, no God, nothing but Father Stalin. I would quote scriptures never exceeding the knowledge of a poor village priest could be expected to have. At one such discussion, Boris was present, leaning up against the dog compound, idly chewing a sliver of glass. "Sergeant," claimed the captain in exasperation, "the priest has never been out of his little village. Take him around and show him the city. Take him on patrol to Arthem and to Ranzoil. Show him life. He only knows about death, thinking that that is life." He spat on the ground, lit a contraband cigarette, and stalked away. "Yes, come on, priest. You have stayed with the dogs so long, you are beginning to look like them. Though I must admit, you have them well behaved now, and you did win me a pile of money. I float on air with it, priest, and must spend it before I die." He led the way to a car, got in, and motioned for me to do the same. He started the engine, moved the gear lever, and let in the clutch. Off we went, bouncing on the rutted roads, rearing into the narrow streets of Vladivostok. Down by the harbor, there were many ships, almost more ships than I had known existed in the world. "Look, priest," said Boris, "those ships have captured goods which are going to lend lease from the Americans
to some other country. They think the Japanese captured them. But we shipped the cargoes over the railroads, the Trans-Siberian railways, back to Moscow, where the party bosses have what they think is first pick. We have first pick because we have arrangement with the dog. We turn a blind eye on their doings while they turn a blind eye on ours. Have you ever had a watch, priest? No, I replied. I have owned very little in my life. I know the time by the position of the sun and the shadows. You must have a watch, priest. Boris speeded up the car, and shortly he drew alongside a freighter moved to the sparkling with dry salt spray. Moved to the dockside. The ship was streaked with the red rust and sparkling with dried salt spray. The journey round the Golden Horn had been a hard and rough one. Cranes were swinging their long jibes, unloading the produce from different parts of the world. Men were shouting, gesticulating, manipulating cargo nets and pulling on hawsers. Boris jumped out, dragging me with him, and rushed madly up the gangplank, still with me in tow. "We want watches, Captain," he bawled at the first man in uniform. "Watches for the arm." A man with a more ornate uniform than the others appeared and motioned us to his cabin. "Watches, Captain," bawled Boris. "One for him, two for me. You want to come ashore, Captain? Good time ashore?" "Do what you like. Girls, get drunk. We not interfere. We want watches." The captain smiled and poured drinks. Boris drank his noisily, and I passed mine to him. "Hey, no drink, Captain. He a priest turned dog watcher. Good dog watcher too. Good fellow," said Boris. The captain went to a space beneath his bunk and drew out a box. Opening it, he displayed perhaps a dozen wristwatches. Almost quicker than the eyes could see, Boris picked two gold ones and without bothering to wind them, slipped one on each arm. "Take a watch, priest," commanded Boris. I reached out and took a chromium one. "This is better one, priest," said the captain. "This is stainless steel, waterproof Omega, a far better watch." "Thank you, Captain," I replied. "If you have no objection, I will have the one of your choice." "Now I know you are crazed, priest," said Boris. "A steel watch when you can have gold?" I laughed and replied, "Steel is good enough for me. You are a sergeant, but I am only a very temporary corporal." From the ship, we went to the Trans-Siberian Railroad sidings. Work gangs were busily loading trucks with the choicest goods from ships. From here, the trucks would leave for Moscow, some 6,000 miles away. As we stood there, one train moved out. Two engines pulled a vast array of railroad cars, each engine with five wheels on each side. Giant things which were well kept and which were regarded almost as living creatures by the train crew. Boris drew along beside the tracks. Guards were everywhere. From pits in the ground, armed men scanned the undersides of the passing trains, looking for stowaways. "You seem to be very afraid of anyone illegally riding the trains," I asked. "This is a thing which I do not understand. What harm could it do to allow people to take a ride?" "Priest," sadly said Boris, "you have no knowledge of life, just as the captain said. Enemies of the party, saboteurs, the capitalist spy would try to steal into our cities. No honest Russian would want to travel unless so directed by his commissar." "But are there many trying to take rides? What do you do with them when you see them?" "Do with them? Why, shoot them, of course. Not many stowaways just here, but tomorrow I am going to Arthem and I will take you. There you will see how we deal with such subversive elements. The train crews, when they catch one, tie his hands, slip a rope around his neck and throw him off. Make a mess of the track though, and encourages the wolves." Boris slumped in the driving seat, his eyes scanning the packed railway cars. trundling along. As if electrified, he sat bolt upright and jabbed the accelerator right down. The car leaped ahead and raced right past the head of the train. Slamming on the brakes, Boris jumped out, grabbed his submachine gun, and hid by the side of the car. Slowly, the train rumbled by. I caught a glimpse of someone riding between two railroad coaches, and then there was a shuddering stammer of the submachine gun. The body tumbled to the ground between the tracks. "Got him," said Boris triumphantly, as he carefully cut another nick in the stock of his gun. "That makes 53, priest. 53 enemies of the state accounted for." I turned away, sick at heart and afraid to show it. For Boris would have shot me as easily as he has shot the man if he had known I was not just the village priest. The train passed on and Boris walked to the riddled bleeding body. Turning it over with his foot, he looked at the face and said, I recognize this as a railroad worker. He should not have been riding. Perhaps I should blow off his face so there will be no difficult questions." So saying, he put the muzzle on the gun near the face of the dead man and pulled the trigger, leaving the now headless corpse. "I have never been on a train, Boris," I said. "Well," he replied, "tomorrow we will go to Artem by goods train and you can look around. I have some good friends there and I want you to meet now that I am a sergeant." For long I had cherished the idea of stowing away aboard some ship and steaming off to America. I mentioned ship stowaways to Boris. "Boris," I said, "you spend all your time stopping people at the frontier and making sure there are no stowaways on the trains. Yet all these ships, anyone could walk aboard and stay." Boris leaned back and roared with laughter. "Priest," he guffawed, "you must be a simpleton. The water guards board the ships a mile from the shore and they check all members of the crew. Then they seal all the hatches and ventilators and pour cyanide gas into the holds, other spaces, not forgetting the lifeboats. They get a good bag of stiffs from reactionaries who did not know about this." I felt very sick at the callous manner in which these men treated the whole affair as sport, and I hastily changed my mind about stowing aboard a ship. Here I was in Vladivostok, but I had my allotted task in life, and as the prophecy had stated, I had to go first to America, then to England, and back to the North American continent. The problem was how to get out of this part of the world. I determined to find out as much as possible about the Trans-Siberian railways, where the checks and searches ended, and what happened at the Moscow end. The next day I exercised and fed the dogs early, and with them well settled, I set out with Boris and three other guards. We travelled some 50 miles to the utmost post where three guards were to replace three others. All the way the men were chatting about how many escapees they had shot, and I picked up some useful information. I learned the point at which there were no more checks. I learned that if one was careful, one could travel to the outskirts of Moscow without being caught. Money was going to be a problem that I could see. I made money by standing duty for other men, by treating their ills, and through the good offices of some of them, treating wealthy party members in the city itself. Like others, I arranged to visit ships and took my share of the spoils of new train loads. All my bounty was turned into rubles. I was prepared to cross Russia. Nearly 5 weeks later, the captain told me that the dogs were now going back to their patrol stations. A new commissar was coming and I must leave before he arrived. "Where was I going?" he asked. Knowing my man by now, I replied, "I will remain in Vladivostok. Comrade captain, I like it here." His face grew apprehensive. "You must leave. Get right out of the district tomorrow." "But comrade captain, I have nowhere to go. No money," I answered. "You shall be given ruble, food, clothing, and taken out of this district." "Comrade captain," I reiterated, "I have nowhere to go. I have worked hard here and I want to stay in Vladivostok. The captain was adamant. Tomorrow we send men to the very limit of our area, to the boundary of Voroshilov. You shall be taken there and left. I will give you a letter saying that you have helped us and you have gone there with our permission. Then Voroshilov police will not arrest you. This was far better than I had hoped. I wanted to get to Voroshilov because that was where I intended to board the train. I knew that if I could get to the other side of the city, I would be fairly safe. The next day, with a number of other men, I climbed aboard a fast troop carrier and we roared up the road on the way to Voroshilov. This time I was wearing a good suit of clothes and had a large rucksack stuffed with belongings. I also had a shoulder bag full of food. It gave me not a qualm to remember that the clothes I wore had been taken from a dead ship jumper. "Don't know where you're going, priest," said Boris, "but captain said that he trained those dogs, so you had to leave. You can sleep at the outpost tonight and be on your way in the morning." That night I was unsettled. I was sick and tired of roaming from place to place, sick and tired of living with death nudging my elbows. I was utterly lonely, living with these people who were so alien, so absolutely opposed to my peaceful way of living. In the morning, after a good breakfast, I said goodbye to Boris and others, shouldered my load, and set off. Mile after mile I covered, avoiding the main road, trying to circle Voroshilov. There was the roar of a speeding car behind me, the squeal of hastily applied brakes, and I found myself looking down the muzzle of a submachine gun. "Who are you? Where are you going?" snarled a scowling corporal. "I'm on my way to Voroshilov," I replied. "I have a letter from the comrade Captain Vasily." Snatching the letter from me, he tore it open, frowning in concentration of reading. Then his face broke into a broad grin. "We have just come from Sergeant Boris," he said. "Get in, we will drive you to Voroshilov and let you off where you say." This was a nuisance. I was trying to avoid the city, but I climbed into the patrol car and was speedily driven to Voroshilov. I alighted near the police headquarters, and as the car shot off into the garage, I walked smartly along, trying to cover as many miles as possible before nightfall. I planned to camp out near the railroad and observe what had happened for a night and day before climbing aboard. Passenger trains were stopped and checked at Voroshilov, but the goods train stopped just outside, possibly so that the local people could not see how many stowaways were killed. I watched and watched and decided that my only hope was to get on a train just as it was pulling out. On the night of the second day, a very desirable train stopped. A train which my experience told me had many land lease cargoes aboard. This was not to be missed, I thought, as I eased myself along the tracks, peering under, testing locked doors, opening those which were not locked. Every now and then a shot rang out, followed by thud of a falling body. Dogs were not used here for fear that they might be killed by the wheels. I rolled in the dust, making myself as dirty as possible. The guards came by, peering at the train, shouting to each other, flashing powerful lamps. No one thought to look behind the train. The train only engaged their attention. I, prone on the ground behind them, thought my dogs would be far more efficient than this. Dogs would soon have found me. The men, satisfied with their search, strolled off. I rolled sideways to the track and drafted between the wheels of a railroad car. Quickly, I climbed to an axle and hitched a rope I had ready to a projected lug. Fastening it to the other side, I drew myself up and tied myself to the bottom of the railroad car floor, in the only position which would escape scrutiny. This I had planned for a month. The train started with a jerk and nearly dislodged me. And as I anticipated, a jeep with a spotlight came racing alongside. with armed guards peering at axle bars. I drew myself tighter to the floor, feeling as a naked man would before a convention of nuns. The jeep raced on and turned and came back and passed out of sight and life. The train rumbled on. For 5 or 6 miles, I held grimly to my painful position. Then, convinced that danger was over, I slowly eased myself out from the rope and managed to balance on one of the covers of the axles. For a time, I rested as best I could, getting feeling back into my cramped and aching limbs. Then slowly, cautiously, I edged myself along to the end of the railroad car and managed to grasp an iron bar. For perhaps half an hour, I sat on the couplings. Then drawing myself onto that same platform, swaying, I crept blindly around the end and onto the roof. It was quite dark now, except for the starlight. The moon had not yet risen, and I knew I had to work fast to get inside a wagon before any prowling trainsmen saw me in the Siberian moonlight. On the roof, I tied an end of the rope around me, passed the other end around the roof rail, and slid cautiously down over the side, paying out the rope I held. Bumbling and scrapping along through the rough edges, I soon managed to unlock the door with a key which I had obtained in Vladivostok for the purpose. One key fitted all the train locks. It proved to be fantastically difficult to slide the door open as I swung like a pendulum, but sight of the first rays of the bright moon gave me the extra impetus. The door slid open and I crawled exhaustedly inside. Relinquishing the free end of the rope, I jerked and pulled until the whole length was in my hand. Shaking with utter exhaustion, I slid under the door, shut the door and dropped to the floor. 2 or 3 days later, one loses all kind of time under such conditions. I felt the train slowing. Hurrying to the door, I opened it a creak and peered out. There was nothing to be seen except snow. So I rushed to the other side. Train guards were running along like a group of refugees. Obviously, a big search was underway. Picking up my belongings, I dropped over the side into the snow. Dodging and twisting between the wheels of the track, I managed to completely confuse my snow trail. While I was still at it, the train started to move, and I grabbed desperately at the nearest icy coupling. By the great fortune, I managed to get my arm around one, and I hung there, feet dangling, until a sudden jolt enabled me to get my legs up as well. Standing up, I found that I was at the end of a truck which was covered with a stiff, frozen tarpaulin. The knots were solid ice. The heavy canvas was like sheet iron. I stood upon the swaying, icy-covered coupling, battling with the icy knots. I breathed upon them, hoping that they would soften, but my breath froze and made the ice thicker. I dragged the rope backwards and forwards against the metal of the side truck. Darkness was falling, and when the last frayed strand parted and I was able with immense effort to prise up an edge of the canvas and crawl inside. Inside, as I fell to the floor, a man jumped at me, flailing a piece of sharp steel at my throat. Instinct and habit came to my rescue, and the man was soon nursing a broken arm and moaning. 2 other men came at me, one with an iron bar, one with a broken, jagged bottle. To one with my training, they presented no real problem. They were soon disarmed. Here was the law of the jungle. The strongest man was king. Now I had beaten them. They were my servants. The wagon was full of grain, which I ate just as it was. For drink, we collected snow and sucked ice which we broke from the tarpaulin. We could get no warmth, for there was nothing to burn, and the train crew would have seen the smoke. I could manage with the cold, but the man with the broken arm froze solid one night and we had to dump him over the other side. Siberia is not all snow. Parts of it are mountainous, like the Canadian Rockies, and other parts are as green as Ireland. Now, though, we were troubled with snow, for this was the worst season in which to be traveling. We found that the grain disturbed us badly. It caused us to swell up and gave us severe dysentery, weakening us so much that we hardly cared whether we lived or died. At last, the dysentery abated, and we suffered the sharp pangs of starvation. I lowered myself over the side with my rope and scraped the grease from the axle boxes. We ate that, wretched horribly in the process. The train rumbled on along the edge of Lake Baikal onto Osmuk. Here, as I know, it would be shunted and reassembled. I should have to leave before reaching the city and jumped aboard another train which had been remade. There is no point in detailing all the trials and tribulations of the change of trains, but I and the company, in company with the Russian and the Chinaman, managed to board a fast freight train to Moscow. The train was in good condition. My carefully preserved key opened a wagon and we clambered inside, hidden by the darkness of a moonless night. The wagon was very full and we had to force our way in. There was no glimmer of light and we had no idea of the contents. A pleasant surprise awaited us in the morning. We were staring and I saw that one corner of the wagon was stacked with Red Cross parcels which had apparently not reached the destination but had been liberated by the Russians. Now we lived well. Chocolate, canned food, canned milk, everything. We even found in a parcel a little stove with a supply of solid smokeless fuel. Investigating the bales, we found them to be full of clothing and articles which could have been looted from Shanghai stores. Cameras, binoculars, watches. We fitted ourselves out in good clothes, for ours were in shocking state. Our greatest need was for water. We had to depend upon the snow which we could scrape off ledges. 4 weeks and 6,000 miles after I left Vladivostok, the train was approaching Noginsk, some 30 or 40 miles from Moscow. The three of us held a discussion and decided that as the train crew were becoming active, we heard them walking across our roofs. We would be wise to leave. Very carefully, we inspected each other to make sure that there was nothing suspicious about us. Then we picked a very good supply of food and treasures with which to barter. The Chinaman went first and we slid the door shut after him. I heard rifle fire. 3 or 4 hours later, the Russian dropped off, followed by me after a half-hour interval. I plodded along in the dark, quite sure of my way. For the Russian, a native Moscow who had been exiled in Siberia, had carefully coached us. By morning, I had covered a good 20 miles and my legs, so badly battered in prison camps, were troubling me greatly. In an eating place, I showed my papers as a corporal in the frontier guards. These were Andrey's, and I had been told that I could have all his belongings and no one would have thought of adding except his official papers and identity card. The waitress looked doubtful and called a policeman who was standing outside. He came in and there was much discussion. No, I had no food ration card and I had inadvertently left it in I had inadvertently left it in Vladivostok. Food regulations were not enforced for the guards at Vladivostok. The policeman fiddled with my papers and then said, "You will have to eat on the black market until you can get to the food bureau and obtain another card. They will have to get in touch with Vladivostok first." With that, he turned and walked away. The waitress shrugged her shoulders. "Have what you like, comrade. It will cost you 5 times the official price." She bought me some sour black bread and some awful-looking and worse-tasting paste. She misunderstood my signs for drink and brought me some stuff which almost made me pass out on the spot. One sip of it and I thought I had been poisoned. One sip was enough, but the waitress even charged me for water while she slurped up the vile brew for which I had paid so much. As I left, the policeman was waiting. He fell into step as I walked along. "This is very irregular, comrade, walking with a pack on your back. I wonder if I should not take you to the station for interrogation. Have you a spare watch on you, comrade, to make me forget my duty?" Silently, I fumbled in my pocket, and then I produced one of the watches I had taken from the train. The policeman looked at it, glanced at it, and said, "Moscow, straight ahead. Avoid the main thoroughfare, and you will be all right." Then he turned and walked away. I plodded along the side roads, keeping a good lookout for policemen who might demand watches. It seemed to me, from my own experience, that Russians had a simply dreadful craving for watches. Some of them could not tell the time, but the mere fact of having a watch seemed to satisfy them in some strange manner. An emaciated man tottering ahead of me suddenly swayed and fell on his face in the gutter at the side of the road. Passers-by did not even glance at him, but went their way. I made as if to go when an old man just behind me muttered, "Careful, comrade, stranger. If you go to him, the police will think you are looting. He is dead anyway. Starvation. It happens to hundreds here every day." Noting my thanks, I walked straight on. "This is a terrible place," I thought, "with every man's hand against his fellows. It must be because they have no religion to guide them." That night I slept behind the crumbling wall of a derelict church, slept with about 300 others for company. My rucksack was my pillow, and during the night I felt stealthy hands trying to unfasten the straps. A quick blow to the would-be thief's throat sent him gasping and reeling backwards, and I was not troubled again. In the morning, I bought food on the government black market, for in Russia, the government runs the black market, and then continued on my way. The Russian on the train had told me to pose as a tourist and to hang a camera taken from the train around my neck. I had no film in those days, hardly knew one side of the camera from the other. Soon I found myself in a better part of Moscow, the part that the ordinary tourists see, for the ordinary tourist does not see behind the scenes the misery, poverty, and the death which existed in the slumside streets. The Moscow River was before me, and I walked along its bank for a time before turning up into Red Square. The Kremlin, the tomb of Lenin, impressed me not at all. I was used to the grandeur and sparkling beauty of the Potala. Near an entrance to the Kremlin, a small group of people waited, apathetic, slovenly, looking as if they had been driven there like cattle. With a swoosh, three huge black cars rushed out across the square and disappeared into obscurity of the seats. As people were looking dully in my direction, I half raised the camera. Suddenly, I felt a terrific pain shoot through my head. For a moment, I thought that a building had fallen on me. I fell to the ground and the camera was smashed from my hands. Towering Soviet guards stood above me. One of them was methodically and unemotionally kicking me in the ribs in order to make me rise to my feet. Half stunned as I was, it was difficult for me to rise. So two policemen reached down and roughly dragged me to my feet. They fired questions at me, but they spoke so rapidly and in such a Moscow accent, I understood not a word. At last, tired of asking questions and getting no reply, they marched me off along the Red Square. A policeman on each side and one behind me with a huge revolver poking painfully into my spine. We stopped at a dismal looking building and entered by a basement door. I was roughly pushed, shoved would be a better word, down some stone steps into a small room. An officer was sitting at a table with two armed guards standing by a wall of the room. The senior policeman in charge of me grappled out a lengthy explanation to the officer and placed my rucksack on the floor beside him. The officer wrote what was obviously a receipt for me and for my belongings, and then the policeman turned and left. I was roughly pushed into another corner, a very large one, and left standing before an immense desk with an armed guard on each side of me. Sometime later, three men came in and seated themselves at the desk and went through the contents of my rucksack. One rang for an attendant and when he entered, gave him my camera, giving him brusque instructions. The man turned and went off, carefully carrying the inoffensive camera as if it were a bomb about to explode. They kept on asking me questions which I could not understand. At last they called an interpreter, then another and another until they found one who could converse with me. I was stripped of my clothes and examined by a doctor. All the seams of my clothes were examined and some of them were ripped open. At last my clothes were flung at me, less buttons, less belt and shoelaces. At a command, the guard hustled me out of the room carrying my clothes and marched me along corridor after corridor. They made no sound. Felt slippers were on their feet, nor did they speak to each other or to me. As we marched silently along, a really blood-curdling scream rose and fell quivering on the still air. I involuntarily slowed down, but the guard behind me jumped to my shoulder with such force that I thought he had broken my neck. At last we stopped at a red door. A guard unlocked it and I was pushed in to fall headlong down 3 stone steps. The cell was dark and very damp. It was about 6 feet by 12 feet, with a foul and stinking mattress on the floor. For a quite unknown time, I stared there in darkness, becoming hungrier and hungrier, wondering why mankind had such a savage nature. After a very long interval, a hunk of sour black bread and a small jug of brackish water was passed in. The silent guard motioned to me to drink the water then. I took a gulp and he snatched the jug from my lips, pouring the water to the floor and went out. The door closed silently. There was no sound except the occasional hideout screams, which were quickly and violently, hideous screams which were quickly and violently suppressed. Time crawled on. I nibbled at the sour black bread. I was hungry and thought I could have eaten anything, but this bread was terrible. It stank as if it had been dragged through a cesspool. A long time after, so long I feared I was quite forgotten, armed guards came silently to my cell. Not a word was spoken. They gestured to me to go with them. Having no choice, I did so, and we trampled through endless corridors, giving me the impression that we were retracing our steps time after time in order to build up suspense. At last, I was marched into a long room which had a brightly painted white wall at one end. Roughly, the guards manacled my arms behind me and turned me to face the white wall. For long moments, nothing happened. Then very powerful, utterly dazzling lights were switched on so as to reflect from the white wall. I felt as if my eyeballs were being scorched. Even with my eyes shut, the guards wore dark glasses. The light beat down in waves. The sensation was as if needles were being pushed into my eyes. A door softly opened and shut. A scrape of chairs and rustle of papers. A low voice muttered conversation which I did not understand. Then the blow of a rifle butt between my soldiers and the questioning began. Why had I a camera which had no film in it? Why had I the papers of a frontier guard stationed in Vladivostok? How? Why? When? Hour after hour, the same stupid question. A light blazed on, giving me a splitting headache. A blow from the gun butt if I refused to answer. The only respite was for a few moments every 2 hours when the guards and questionnaires were replaced by fresh ones. But the guards too, because exhausted by the bright lights. After what seemed to be endless hours, but which in reality could not have been more than 6, I collapsed on the floor. Guards quite unemotionally began pricking me with sharpened bayonets. I struggled to my feet with my arms fixed behind me was difficult, but I did it again and again. When I became unconscious, buckets of cesspool water were thrown over me. Hour after hour, the questioning went on. My legs began to swell, my ankles became thick, and my thighs as the body fluids drained down and made the flesh waterlogged. Always the same questions, always the same brutality. 60 hours of standing, 70 hours. The world was a red haze. I was all but dead on my feet. No food, no rest, no respite. just a drink of some sleep-preventing drug forced into my mouth. Questions, 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 72 hours. I heard no more, saw no more. The questions, the light, the pain all faded, and there was blackness. An unspecified time elapsed, and I regained a pain-filled consciousness, flat on my back on the cold wet floor of a reeking cell. It was agony to move, my flesh felt soggy, and my back felt as if the spine were made of broken glass. No sound there was to show that others were alive, no glimmer of light to mark night from day, nothing but an eternity of pain, hunger and thirst. At last there was a clink of light as a guard roughly shoved a plate of food onto the floor. A can of water slopped beside it. The door shut and again I was alone with my thoughts in the darkness. Much later the guards came in and I was dragged, I could not walk, to the interrogation room. There I had to sit and write my life history. For 5 days the same thing happened. I was taken to a room, given a pencil stub and paper and told to write everything about myself. For 3 weeks I remained in my cell, recovering slowly. Once again, I was taken to a room where I stood before 3 high officials. One glanced at others, looked at the papers in my hand and told me that certain influential people had testified that I had helped people in Vladivostok. One testified that I had helped his daughter escape from a Japanese prisoner of war camp. You will be released, said the official, and taken to Strzyżki in Poland. We have a detachment of men going there. You will accompany them. Back to a cell, a better one this time, while my strength was built up enough to enable me to travel. At last I marched through the gates of Lubyanka prison, Moscow, on my way to the West. And that's the end of chapter 3.